prokaryotes are going to encompass the domains bacteria and archaea, or archaea, however you want to say that. So just a little review of terms. Prokaryotic and eukaryotic. Prokaryotic, pro means before, karyotic means nucleus. These cells evolved before cells with a nucleus evolved. Remember on the clock, they came way, way, like at least a billion years before the eukaryotes. They do not have a nucleus. Think about what that fundamentally means. It means that their genetic material is just with everything else inside of their cells. Is that good? What if you have metabolic reactions that happen out in the cytoplasm around your genetic material? That could be bad. We have this whole nuclear protection. And when we have metabolic things that happen in the cytoplasm, our genetic material is protected from that. So there's a huge advantage. But there's also advantages to being simple. They've been around for billions of years. Again, humans only been around for maybe 6 million years, and we're not like winning. So they've been winning for a long time. Eukaryotic cells. U means true, periodic, nucleus. They have a nucleus, they're more complex. Membranes. The nucleus is enclosed in a nuclear membrane. All of our organelles have membranes. Membranes are really, really great in the eukaryotic cells because they allow for things to come in and out of the cell selectively, or in and out of the organelles selectively. So you can control what the cytoplasm is exposed to. There's also vesicles and vacuoles that, when you have a metabolic reaction, you can package up your products, good or bad, waste products, or the product intended, and then you could put them in these little membranes and float them to places where they can be properly released. So there's a lot of really big advantages to having membranes. Remember that we have three domains. Bacteria and archaea share a common ancestor. It's believed that the archaeans are the, what did you call it again?
LUCA, Last Universal Common Ancestor, and
the
scientists believe that like LUCA had like pretty much the minimum requirements for a cell, like just like a cell membrane, cytoplasm, ribosomes, and then like RNA just kind of floating around.
Yeah,
there.
Some genetic material.
And that was it.
Simplicity is amazing. And then the eukarya have a common ancestor with the archaea. All right, so remember again, when we're looking at those trees, the phylogenetic trees, that there's a common ancestor every time you have the branching. There's three most common shapes. There's other shapes, of course, but the three most common shapes, one is spherical or round, a sphere. We call that cocci. Rod-shaped, bacilli. And helical-shaped or spiral-shaped, spirilli. Sorry, spirilla. I always say spirilli. Spirilla. They look snaky. But think about there, if you saw them in three dimensions, they'd look like a helix. Kind of like our DNA shape.
Does the way the word ends have anything to do with, because this one says basilia, what is it?
Bacilli.
So
probably. Probably. Yeah. What it is. There's a lot to know in biology, which is like the amazing thing. It's one of the things I love about the field is that there's always more to learn. So again, you can see this one's even better picture, looking like DNA, like is the spirilla. I'm gonna ask my office mate, Jesus Micro, that question today. The rod shape, the bacilli, and the cocci, the round. In which of these situations would you find prokaryotes? Intestinal tract, polar ice caps, deep sea vents, mud puddle, all of these. Where do you think they are?
I would say all of them.
Yeah, they're everywhere.
Everywhere.
They're everywhere. Prokaryotes reproduce by fission. They grow to twice their size and they split in two. Imagine if you just started doing that in class. That'd be wild. The simplest form of reproduction. You have to be simple in nature internally to be able to do this. Is this like even hypothetical in a human to do fission? That'd be crazy. We have so many different kinds of cells, tissues, organs. We're too complex. So the more simplistic, the more likely you're doing fission. They are almost genetically identical. Of course, we know that mutations do occur even when we're just copying something to be identical, that mutations can occur. So here's what it looks like. You have a picture on your page there that when you have a cell about this size, they grow to twice their size, they start to form a cell wall in between, because these do have a cell wall, and then they just eventually pinch off and become two separate organisms. Yeah. They can do this about every 20 minutes. Of course, that depends on the species. Some longer, some maybe shorter. And again, because mutation is always a possibility when you're copying the genetic material, it allows for quick evolution. So even though they're not going through this whole process like we are, with sperm and egg come together, and then you have the process of meiosis that also allows for more mutations and combinations to occur, even though this is like really, really simple, remember that just anytime a cell copies its DNA, there's the possibility of mutation to happen. Also remember that mutations can be bad to the organism. They can be nothing. It's kind of equal, or it could be really good. So what is important are those good ones for the prokaryotes, which allow them to enhance their survival and also spread that mutation quickly in the population, because that thing that enhances their survival is an advantageous trait. And when you have an advantageous trait, you typically survive easier, and then that starts to over time make its way at higher percentage into the population. Bacterial resistance to antibiotics. It's bad for us, but it is good for their survival. They also can do what's called, this is wild, horizontal gene transfer, HGT. Different species can share their genetic material. Different species can share their genetic material. Wait, didn't we just say, like, when we talked about evolution, that you can't mate with something that is not of the same species, but this isn't mating? It's like mating. It's a little bit different, where they can share genes without mating. Whoa. Some eukaryotes can do it. Jumping genes and corn can do it, but prokaryotes are real good at this. This is wild stuff. All right, so the way they do it is called conjugation. Look, in quotes, mating. It's not, there's no sperm and egg used. There's no sperm and egg used. It's not sexual reproduction. So that's why we don't call it full out, just like no quote mating. It's like mating, but it's not. These are clearly two different species, because this one has all of these fuzzy things on there. This one doesn't. And then they make this bridge between them, and what they can share is typically they're not sharing. They have one of the things about the prokaryotes is that they will have their main genetic material is a nucleoid and it's a circular chromosome, but they also have other accessory DNA or RNA. They have accessory genetic material that float out in the cytoplasm, and they're called plasmids. And these, even though they're not in the main, they are still important, and they still carry important genes, and they can transfer important genes between different species, amongst their own species, but amongst different species. So when you have these two, which make this bridge between them, they can shoot plasmids to each other. And what if on those plasmids there is resistance to different kinds of antibiotics? They can become those super bugs that we're all so worried about right now, that we should be worried about. So it's pretty interesting. They can do it one of two ways. One is that they can, their cell membranes can fuse shortly. Just a quick period of time, the cell membranes fuse and they pass amongst them. They make a cytoplasmic bridge and then they can shoot those plasmids to each other. The other thing is that they have what's called a sex pilus. Pili are like flagella, but they're not used for swimming. And so then they can like poke with a pilus, a pilus. Pili is more than one. They can poke with a pili. They can poke with a pilus into another prokaryote and then shoot over some plasmids. It's kind of like thinking about sex, like poking with a penis, right? It's kind of that idea, but not a penis. So this produces new genetic combinations in the prokaryotes. Whoa. Pretty cool for them, pretty not cool for us. One of the many reasons, the simplicity of them, the ease in which they can reproduce, the ability to share DNA amongst different organisms has allowed them, all of these are very advantageous traits for them and their lengthy amount of time of survival. So by what process are bacteria able to gain resistance to antibiotics? What a nice test question. Forming endospores, meiosis, conjugation, sexual reproduction, mitosis. So conjugation, we just talked about that. Easy now, but if I put that on an exam, you might be like, oh, crick, what was that? Check this out. A pathogen can be a bacterium, but not all bacteria are pathogens. What does that mean? Not all bacteria are bad. Pathogenic, the term, did I tell you yet? Pathogenic means disease-causing, which I have somewhere in this lecture. And I think that's one of the things about humans is that we have associated bacteria with bad. But it's like, I had one of my old office mates, he told me 1% of 1% of 1% of bacteria are actually pathogenic. So there's just so few that are actually pathogenic. The majority of them are really important to us, to other organisms, beneficial, symbiotic, important part of what we're a new exploding field of research, the microbiome. I guess it's not new, but it is kind of exploding now. That we're looking at what do they do for us? What do they indicate? What are they telling us? So we can't survive without them. Can they survive without us? Probably. They probably don't need us. There's probably some that might die off without us, but. The term bad bacteria, frustrating, really frustrating. Pathogenic means disease causing, but they're not bad. Most bacteria are good. This is why, you know, I mean, this has become a necessity because of a global pandemic. but before that, this is not the best thing because it kills your microbiome too. Kill a lot of our beneficial bacteria. And I hate to say good bacteria and our bad bacteria, right? But this has become an interesting thing over time.
Even the pathogenic bacteria actually can be considered beneficially because they control our population.
Oh, for sure. Yeah, just like cordyceps, right? What we saw with the insects and fungi. So there's a lot of, that's like a framing of bad and good. It's like you have to think more about like evolution. If you're in a biological mind, we think about advantageous, not advantageous, and time. And yeah, so there's a lot of different factors.
I was going to say, does like soap have the same effect in that it kills the bacteria, or does it do something else?
So, we use a lot more alcohol base, which is a dehydrating factor. This is 70% alcohol, so the fact of like the dehydration of these individual cells is really important. There used to be, in a lot of these, triclosan, which was like an antibiotic base that they would put in here. And then bacteria started to evolve resistance to triclosan. And so now, since before the pandemic even, the alcohol-based ones have become a lot more predominant. Yeah, so, but it also, like, then dehydrates your...
That's why when I use it too much, I get, like, a red skin.
Yeah, which also then, if you use it so much, you get cuts in your skin, and then...
Yeah.
Opens you up to other things. But washing hands is a really, it's better for you than 70% alcohol is really drying. So this I would use in a like emergency situations, but where you can wash your hands 20 seconds. Who's still washing their hands for 20 seconds? Every time you go to the restroom, you go, there's like maybe a few times a day, just washing your hands every couple hours for 20 seconds. I have people look at me all the time like, oh, you're still doing that? I was always doing that. And they go like, really? Yeah, that's like what we always should be doing. Wait one second.
Do they use like iodine before surgeries? Like, I don't know what it is, but it's just-
The reddish like stuff, yes, yes.
So why is-
Yeah, betadine.
So what's the difference between that and-
Oh, who's my surgeons in here? I'm not sure the exact difference, but it is a similar effect to this, but I think it also covers, I want to say, some of the, like, I might misspeak, gram-negative bacteria as well that are pathogenic, so I think it has a wider spectrum than just what this can do.
Isn't it alcohol? The betadine?
No.
Because you pour it on cuts and stuff.
Yeah. Okay. So I believe it targets those more pathogenic ones, I hope. You're good now?
So I remember when I got shoulder surgery, they put it like all over my left shoulder, like on my chest and like everywhere.
Everywhere that they might accidentally touch and then bring to that area. Yeah, they'll like coat you in it and they'll do it for a while and they're gonna really ensure that they knock everything out. Did you wanna say something? Okay, so what's the abundance of prokaryotes? A drop of seawater. So you think like salt water would have none. Nah, they're everywhere. Hundreds of thousands in a drop. In a drop. Hundreds of thousands. Thousands. Not even like thousands. Hundreds of thousands. A spoonful of soil contains billions. There's been a lot of research to say that kids who play outside when they're, I would say kids who play outside when they're young, when kids play outside in the dirt, they have a healthier microbiome than kids who are more like on their iPad and their devices because they're exposed to a lot more diversity of beneficial prokaryotes.
Well, I was one of those kids that just play outside all the time, so I probably make it pretty great.
Trillions, we have trillions, probably even bigger than trillions in our body, in and on our body.
All the clean free parents that I know, like, not that your house can't be clean, but they're just like a germaphobe and they like bathe their kids like twice a day. Those kids are always getting sick.
Yeah.
Always.
Right. Yep. So there's again, most of them are good. important to get out in nature for so many reasons. So let's talk about extremophile archaea. A lot of the most like wildest, weirdest, craziest prokaryotes fall into the archaea domain. They live in wherever you have like the harshest environments on the earth, you will probably find more archaea than anything else.
Oh, and by the way, this is the hydrophil reflex is like where like glucose theorized.
Okay, right, okay, yeah, which would make sense, right? Because mm-hmm. water, heat, energetic, what we talked about, early earth conditions. So they can live in boiling. If you put your hand into a boiling pot of water, what would happen to your hand? It burned, and eventually, if you just kept it in there, it just melt.
Jeez.
I mean, we wouldn't keep it that long because we have a nervous system that says, hey, dum-dum, get your hand out of there. Boiling environments, like hot springs, hydrothermal vents, where it's like closer to the core of the earth. The core of the earth is very hot. And so then it will spew out chemicals. Chemicals that are, for most organisms, they are toxic. They can live in hot, boiling, toxic environments. Plus, deep in the ocean. If you are a person who drinks bottled water, which we will get to and I will talk about later.
Why do you feel
don't like it? Bottled water, like just thinking about like you carry a case of water, right? It's heavy, one case. What if you carried like 4 cases? Could you carry 4 cases? Maybe some of you, but I know I would be like, no way. I'm gonna do one at a time because they're really heavy. Water is heavy. They live thousands of meters down. That pressure, there's a thing about pressure. You go underwater, the pressure accumulates more and more and more. So these organisms, these archaea that live down here, they can withstand a ton of pressure, which would crush you into a jellyfish. Toxic chemicals coming out and superheat boiling water, all of those awful conditions. They're like, this is great. I love it. It's awesome.
So the time when like you need like a bottle for a couple of days, like have a bottle, you see this kind of like decide like you.
Yeah, you're gonna eat like so if you drink bottled water, you're just paying for carcinogens.
I don't even like bottled water. It tastes too plasticky for me.
Because you're tasting the breakdown of the plastic over days. In the summer, if you keep cases of water in your car, it accelerates that process of the plastics. The PVC thing that's going on, the polyvinyl chloride explosion that happened on the train in Ohio, that's bad. Bad. And it's a lot, there's a lot of really bad politics happening right now, and who's gonna suffer? The people who live there. And you know what? The people who have control over the situation, they really don't care. And it sucks. Anyway, I know. I mean, it makes me furious, furious. The sea ice, they can live in frozen environments. As the icebergs melt, what is going to be released? Maybe good things? Maybe not. Lot to think about there. The Dead Sea, super high salt concentrated water would dehydrate most other organisms. This is great. Okay, pathogens, disease causing organism. They cause disease by producing toxins. So that toxin causes symptoms, conditions to happen in other organisms. Oh, look at that again. What is the best way to protect yourself? What is the best way? Good hygiene. Good hygiene means, again, wash your hands for 20 seconds, often throughout the day, 20. Do it like you're going into surgery. Get the, we like to call these the in-betweenies. Get your, you get some soap, a bunch of soap, and you get your nails. Like you're going into surgery. Do not touch your face. Do not. I always get stuff in my eyes, and so I really try hard to just hard blink it out. it's so much better than you like have touched a million things in the world. Things are floating in the air and go like this, and guess what? You have this whole sinus system that connects down your throat into your lungs. And so the potential to rub something right into your sinuses and get into your lungs. Right? Like how many times, again, I just pointed out, how many times we touch our faces? We just do it, right? We do it a lot of times out of frustration, out of just like it feels good to rub your eyes. Don't do it. Just try and like, so there's that thing. When you sneeze, you gotta like put your hand on your shoulder. And you want to not just go like this, because guess what happens? It just goes out into the air. And so yeah, even better, if you do a double, then you're really like, that's just being kind to other people. Is that when you sneeze? Because I know I see people who'd be like, ah, 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 and I'm like, you didn't even cover your, you're just, it's like, we start doing these weird reactions. So like Caesar, you had a really good one. Cover it up. Clostridium botulinum causes botulism. I just touched my nose. See, I'm like, just talked about it, and I'm like, it's bad habits. Clostridium botulinum, botulism. Botulism will cause paralysis. Causes when you eat food. It'll cause paralysis through your digestive system, but your digestive system has all kinds of circulatory vessels that surround, and they pull the energy and nutrients from your digestive system into your blood, and then that gets distributed around your body. So whatever you eat will be quickly distributed throughout your body through your blood. If this bacteria is in something like usually like dented cans, if you have a dented can, even though you're like, oh my gosh, I'm so poor right now, you should probably throw it away. Because the, like if you get like a little dent and then there's just like a little opening that gets a little bit of rust, they that's where they are attracted to. Rusty anything can cause these, and we'll talk about their cousin as well. But paralysis, they produce a toxin that causes paralysis of your cells. So when that toxin starts to get pulled by your circulatory system and then transported around the body, not only does it start to paralyze your digestive system, but it can start to paralyze everything in your body and causes a full-on paralysis of you.
What if, this is kind of like,
I love your whatevs.
What if, like, you expose yourself to small amounts of it and became immune to it?
One, you're cuckoo. Because remember that they have like, you know, a really quick reproduction. And so they're starting to reproduce, and then the more that you have, the more producing that toxin. So don't do that. I mean, you might do that with a doctor's care, for probably not this. You don't want to mess with this.
What's the shot for rust?
Tendons.
Okay, so that's a cousin, which we'll talk to. But let's talk about this real quick. So somebody who is so brilliant in terms of like those little exposures of this went, okay, so this can paralyze cells in our body. What if I took it and just modified it a little bit, and then I injected it into places where I often like smile, and then over time I get wrinkles from my smiling, and I injected it here, and then I'm like, I'm smiling. Botox is developed from this. So you don't want to just like smear this onto your face. The cousin of that, which we get the tetanus shot for, Clostridium tetani. And what this does is like a rusty nail where you might have Clostridium tetani growing. It's a really good environment for them. It like, let's say it's like on the palm of your hand and you get a cut here, it will paralyze the cut in your hand. And what that does is, excuse me, it causes no circulation. It causes paralysis in that area. So you can't get circulation there. And what circulation does is it brings the white blood cells and all the other agents to clean up cuts. And so then this could go necrotic and you could lose your hand. Tetanus shot, you should get every 10 years. And I know a lot of you are like, when did I last T-DAP or, what's the other one? DTAP is the one we usually get. So like for me, I know on the sevens, I have my lucky number is 7. I get my tetanus shot on the 7s. Remember when you get it, you should get it every 10 years. I do a lot of field work, right? My marine biology class that you're all going to take with me. So I have to have that on the tetanus. It's really important for me. Any of you who are field people or go outside a lot, work on cars, have any kind of hobbies where you might be around like metals that might be rusty. You like to grill. Grills get a lot of rust on them. You got to think of all those situations where you might come across something that's rusty. People throw garbage out everywhere. You could just like walk into your yard and step on a rusty nail. So it's really important to get your tetanus shot every 10 years. So think about if you haven't, if you're not sure, and you're like, maybe ask a family member. Do you know? You can probably, now a lot of stuff is computerized, you probably look it up. One of those My Chart systems, you might be able to find out. So, kind of a good thing.
I was missing mine, and they didn't know if I had it or not, because there was no titers for tetanus, so they gave me one, because they were like, if you had it, a booster doesn't hurt.
Right, exactly. All right, so